I'm not on Reddit often, but one time I was on it, I came across a pretty interesting question. That question was, what filmmaker do you wish had more films? The first three that popped into my head were John Cassavetes, Jeff Nichols, and Jeremy Saulnier. Yes, I'm ashamed Andrei Tarkovsky's name somehow evaded me. So did that of Terrence Malick, one of my all-time favorites. Please forgive me, Terry! Not too much time passed after seeing that Reddit post when I discovered Jeremy Saulnier had a new film coming out, Rebel Ridge. Months later, the weekend it premiered on Netflix, I watched it, enjoyed it, and noticed it was continuing the thematic thread Saulnier had been threading since his debut feature, Murder Party, in 2007. Saulnier cinema, for those who don't know, isn't exactly sweet, but it isn't sour either. His cinema is salty, if anything, and this is quite appropriate considering his surname is French for salt merchant. I'm kind of making this up as I go, but to me, sweet cinema consists of your silly comedies, your sugary romances, and your wholesome family films. Sour cinema, on the other hand, contains your palpably angry or relentlessly depressing or unflinchingly nihilistic films. Then what makes a cinema salty? I don't mean salty in the millennial sense. That would probably be bitter cinema. Salty cinema can surely be dark and tense, but not without humor and or hope. This is Saulnier summed up. Dark and tense, but not without humor and or hope. I don't want to spend this entire video talking about movies in terms of taste buds. That could be a whole other video, I guess. I just want to talk about three key themes I've observed throughout Saulnier's five-film oeuvre. Most would presumably discuss his exploration into the consequences of violence, the futility of vengeance, and the tension between barbarism and civility through alienated and isolated protagonists. This isn't wrong, not at all. But when I was watching Rebel Ridge, what came to my mind were the themes regarding the significance of communication, the art of negotiation, and retaliation versus retribution. The difference is, retribution, according to German philosopher Immanuel Kant, is a proportionate reaction to another action, one that is just against one that was unjust. And retaliation, conversely, is an angry, bitter, spiteful, often violent overreaction to another action, one that is a gross overcorrection to a wrong. Another German philosopher, Friedrich Nietzsche, says in his book On the Genealogy of Morals that revenge is commonly, not always, masked as justice. It appears throughout all of Saulnier's filmography that none of his characters have come across the work of Austrian-Israeli, what a combo, philosopher Martin Buber, who wondered on the concept of I-Thou relationships, where genuine dialogue is essential for connection and understanding. Saulnier's characters failed to engage with one another diplomatically and meaningfully, causing all sorts of disastrous results. His body of work displays what can go awry without proper communication, when people fail to negotiate, and each of his films move further and further away from films with retaliation to films with retribution. Murder Party is a bloody illustration of the chaos that ensues when a group vying for control and power doesn't possess the ability to talk things out and refuses to compromise. The film follows a lonely man named Christopher who is lured into a Halloween costume party, only to realize it's a trap set up by pretentious art students wanting to kill him as an act of art, in hopes of getting a large grant from a man named Alexander. Whoa, voice crack. This crew of murderous conspirators argue with one another on how to execute Christopher. Mason proposes a beheading via chainsaw, a jab at shock factor creators. Sky, a joke on experimental creators, recommends injecting Christopher with an experimental truth serum. Alexander suggests crucifixion, mocking art house creators. Lexi wants to set Christopher on fire, parodying spectacle-driven creators. And Zyko wishes they just let Christopher starve to death, a spoof on lazy, minimalist creators. Eventually, these bozos get bored and use Sky's truth serum on each other, to destructive disaster. Alexander is exposed as a fraud, Bill learns his so-called friends make fun of him behind his back, Mason confesses his love for Lexi, and they all turn on each other. Much of what transpires throughout the film could have been avoided had this group of self-important wannabe artists knew how to talk to each other. The art project could have been carried out flawlessly had they decided beforehand who the project leader would be and how the victim would be executed. Nobody would have died except the one they wanted to kill. Things didn't need to get this complicated and messy, yet due to their egos and personal agendas, because they hid truth from one another, their plan was destined to fail from the beginning. Actually, the whole ordeal probably wouldn't have happened had they known Alexander was a phony from the get-go. So don't hide things, don't lie, lies and secrets will always one day or another be cast into light, causing more pain had everyone just been honest and open from the onset. So all this lack of communication is what leads to the ensuing bloodbath. Instead of sitting down to work things out using dialogue, they opt for violence, reflecting the reality of how people will not address issues head-on. Christopher, while spending most of his intense predicament strapped to a chair, bargains for his life not necessarily through words, but subtly through observation and silence, waiting for the perfect moment as the group tears itself apart to make his escape. Negotiations can be nonverbal. Then comes the climax. Everyone but Bill and Christopher are dead, and Bill is now chasing Christopher. Is it really self-defense, or is it payback when Christopher takes Mason's chainsaw to Bill's head? He was cornered, and Bill had killed multiple people seconds before, but is slicing his head open going too far? Saulnier's first time asking if there's a distinction between revenge and vindication. That's for you, however, the viewer, to decide. 6 years following the release of Murder Party came Saulnier's sophomore flick, Blue Ruin, the one that put him on the map. Blue Ruin, despite dealing more obviously with these three themes, couldn't be more stylistically and tonally different. Like Murder Party, the entire plot of Blue Ruin could have been juked had the two families its conflict is centered around talked it out. The film begins with Dwight Evans, a quiet homeless man, discovering Wade Cleland, the guy convicted for killing Dwight's parents 20 years prior, is being released from prison. So naturally he goes and kills him. For this, predictably, the Clelands want to pursue him, and in the process they lose another family member, Teddy. However, it's revealed that it wasn't Wade who killed Dwight's parents, it was Wade's father, Big Wade. The Clelands decided, as a family, to have Wade Jr. take the heat so that Big Wade, who was terminally ill, didn't have to die sick in prison. It's also revealed Big Wade went after Dwight's father because Dwight's father was banging his wife and Dwight's mother was coincidentally killed in the ambush. Dwight never knew any of this information. Had the two families discussed this stuff like mature adults, separately or together, again, nobody would be dead. Now, due to this lack of communication, Big Wade acted out in a fit of rage, and Dwight reacted based on false assumptions and partial truths. Look where it got them. Vengeance is not a valid form of communication and only leads to more misunderstandings and pain. Revenge is not a noble sentiment. Violence frequently stems from people's inability to express their emotions and resolve conflicts with words instead of weapons. This is similar to Murder Party's conclusion that people often can't or won't deal with problems directly. Dwight's feud with the Clelands forces all sorts of mediations. He has to convince his sister Sam to leave town after he kills Wade in case they go after her. He has to convince his friend Ben to sell him a rifle and hide a body. Dwight tries to convince the Clelands to leave his sister out of their dispute since she had nothing to do with any of it. Dwight arguably even has to convince himself whether or not what he's doing is right. This echoes Nietzsche's thought, he who fights with monsters should look to it that he himself does not become a monster. And so this leads us to the film's main question. Were Dwight's actions retribution? An equitable reaction to Big Wade's action? A persuasive position considering it's not exactly fair the sentence for the murder of his two parents was 20 years in prison as opposed to the death penalty or life in prison without the possibility of parole. Or was it retaliation, a vengeful reaction that brazenly overcompensates Big Wade's action? An understandable take since it wasn't Wade Jr. who technically killed Dwight's parents. Again, and rightly so, Saulnier doesn't want to give you the answer. But to reiterate an earlier point, Dwight's and the Clelands' inability to express their emotions constructively leads them all down a path towards destruction, showcasing how poor communication, a failure to negotiate, and unchecked rage can transform individuals to agents of chaos. The Joker would be proud. Next up is Saulnier's third film, Green Room. Regardless of how simply it handles these three themes, it still might be my personal favorite for how intense and believable it is. Every time I watch the first 30 or 40, 50 minutes of it, it's like I'm watching it again for the first time. It follows a touring DIY punk band, the Ain't Rights, that makes a stop at a music venue out in the boonies of the Pacific Northwest, only to end up witnessing a murder. The music venue is operated and owned by neo-Nazis, and its skinhead head honcho, Darcy, Patrick Stewart, who refuses to let them go in fear the cops will discover his drug lab beneath the building. So, as he and his racist goons try to plan out how they'll frame the band for the murder, he pretends to be working on a plan to let them go safely. Shenanigans ensue. The failure to communicate and negotiate in this case largely falls on Darcy and his neo-Nazi scumbag thugs. The Ain't-Rights really had no bargaining power. Darcy could have rushed them out and said the cops were on their way, that he'd take care of it. He could have convinced them of so many other things to get them to get going. There were plenty of options to let them go peacefully, but his paranoia got the best of him. Because of this, things get real ugly real quick. As the situation escalates, communication and negotiation deteriorate. Diplomatic dialogue shifts into a battle for survival. John Stuart Mill, the British philosopher, even surmised, dire outcomes frequently arise from a failure to partake in necessary discussions. So ultimately, the Ain't-Rights end up taking one of his employees hostage, for example, becoming the monsters Nietzsche warns about in order to stay alive, and by the end of the film, they've killed several red laces to escape. Their fates due, not to revenge, despite fellow bandmates being murdered by them, but due to necessity. Hold the Dark marks Saulnier's first and not last film for Netflix. This is a lot different than your typical Saulnier fare. For one, it's not an original idea. It's based on the eponymous novel. It's also a more cryptic film that, arguably, deals with the supernatural, the first and only Saulnier flick to do so, if you choose to look at it that way. Hold the Dark gives us two storylines, one revolving around Russell Core, a man hired to hunt down wolves responsible for the disappearances of three little kids in an Alaskan village, and the other around Vernon Sloan, the husband of the woman who hired Russell Core, returning from home fighting in Iraq to news that their son is one of the disappeared. The exploration of communication here is actually more so not between people, but between man and nature. Mankind has a special connection to nature, we all know this. We rely on it to feed ourselves, we rely on it to keep ourselves clean and hygienic, we rely on it to provide materials for shelter, we even rely on it to entertain ourselves. It can also help us understand ourselves, our place in the universe, and our creator, if you believe in that sort of thing, like I do. Our existence relies upon our understanding of nature. Russell, in particular, has a deep connection to it, for he has an intimate knowledge of its hazards and rhythms. Taking place in the harsh and merciless frigidity of the Alaskan wilderness, nature is also portrayed as both a reflective energy and an indifferent force. Its stark landscape mirrors the internal struggles of the characters, particularly Vernon, who is a cold-hearted sociopath, while also revealing man's primal instincts and vulnerabilities. Russell's determined quest to hunt down the wolves is an illustration of man trying to reclaim control and seek justice in a cold, dark, unforgiving world. Nature's dangerous unpredictability symbolizes the unpredictability of life. Nature does this not by being a conscious entity, it does this by simply being. This can make it seem like it does have a mind of its own, deliberately punishing or rewarding us, but it does not respond to any of our emotions or thoughts. It knows not what we feel or don't feel, what we want or don't want. It doesn't matter what's happening in our lives, what reasons we have for venturing out in this domain. Nature is going to do what it's designed to do. No matter what we do, nature is never avenging or reacting to our abuse, our expectation of it. Even if it might seem like it is, it's just being, doing what it's designed to do. But there's a little more going on in this mysterious film. Hold the Dark disrupts Saulnier's arc of films finding the difference between retaliation and retribution to explore something new altogether. It's going to be quite difficult to discuss this without spoilers, but I'll do my best. On one hand, Medora Sloan's job for Russell Core appears to be a vengeful one. She wants Russell to kill the wolf she believes devoured her son so that she has something to show her husband, Vernon. Vernon, however, seems to be an animalistic killing machine. He feels nothing gunning down terrorists and killing a rapist in Iraq, and even the folks he murders later on for supposedly being a threat or responsible for his son's disappearance. These violent actions don't appear to be coming from a place of justice. They feel instinctively raw. They come from an emotional, primal place. There's a sense that, in this story, retaliation versus retribution is not a debate. Instead, it's that there is a dark, natural, and old order to things that must be maintained. Again, using this bleak and brutal Alaskan landscape, the setting reinforces this notion. So it's not interested in asking or answering if Vernon's animalistic responses are driven by a desire for justice or not. It's to ponder to what extent is humanity's savagery linked to its environment. Now, finally, to Saulnier's latest flick, Rebel Ridge, a thriller about Terry Richmond, a former Marine who bikes into town with $36,000 to bail his cousin out of prison and to start a new honest life with him. Of course, being Louisiana, he's stopped by police and they take his legally acquired cash through a loophole known as civil forfeiture. These cops don't want to listen to Terry on how and why he has the money and what he's doing in town. They just want to assume and expect the worst. Had they simply listened and talked to Terry, verify his words, the following shenanigans would have never occurred. Neither they or anyone else would have been hurt or busted. So the rest of the film is Terry trying to get the money back the right way, the legal way, and when the justice system isn't interested in helping him, he has to find his own justice, to do what they won't do, but as ethically and morally responsible as he can. In doing so, the story shows Jürgen Habermas's theory of communicative action, where true understanding is virtually impossible by strategically manipulative dialogue and hierarchical systems. Police Chief Sandy's twisting of legal, personal, and verbal agreements mirrors how power imbalances turn communication to a tool for oppression rather than compassionate negotiation. Terry, unlike Sandy, knows how to compromise and make a good deal. His first attempt is letting the corrupt cops keep $26,000 of the $36,000 they stole from him if they just give back $10,000 to bail his cousin out. He'll walk away, leave town, and never report their abuse of power. Sandy initially accepts the deal, but ultimately backs out because of pride. In his mind, what gives Terry, a regular citizen, the right or the authority to make deals with the people of his position? Later, without spoiling too much of the plot, Sandy and Terry try to make another deal. Sandy will give Terry back all the money if he leaves and never shows his face in town ever again. Saulnier's illustration of the corrupt Shelby Springs legal system and police department aligns with Michel Foucault's critique of institutions and power relations, particularly his concept of biopower, where systems control not only bodies, but also behaviors and interactions. One example is how the corrupt police force of Rebel Ridge not only tries to control Terry's body through violence, it also tries to dominate him in the communicative space as it tries to ensure all negotiations are one-sided and insincere. The corruption extends to the realm of discourse, reinforcing Foucault's idea that power permeates all aspects of social relations. Another example from the film would be total spoiler, so I won't go there. If this was any other movie, Terry would beat the crap out of, or even kill, most of these corrupt government officials. But that's not Terry or Rebel Ridge. Terry wants to avoid any and all conflict that he can, yet when they keep betraying their own sworn oath to protect and serve, Terry has no option except to give them a taste of their own medicine. Use the very same system they're corrupting against them. Terry, I would argue, is not indulging in retaliation. Everything he does is as by the book as he can, trying to do the minimal amount of damage possible. What do you do when you realize the very same people you need to report to are the very same perpetrators you need to report about? Did I phrase that right? Anyway, you do what Terry does. John Locke, the English philosopher who influenced much of the Declaration of Independence, even argued that in the absence of an effective justice system, individuals are entitled to respond to protect their rights. Locke's notion of a state of nature where there is no overarching authority to provide protection is vividly on display in Rebel Bridge. So that's that in a nutshell, I guess. I could go on a little deeper, but I didn't want this video to get any longer than it already has, and I don't want to spoil more than I already have, sorry. If you'd like me to expand on any of this, I could, just let me know and I might consider it. Yeah, I might consider it. I kind of hate the sound of my voice, so I can't promise you anything. Anyway, thanks for watching!